Everyone, it's David Bumble coming to you from Cisco Live with a very special guest, Kevin. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Kevin, we were talking off camera. You're wearing a jacket, but we'll forgive you for that if you tell us that you go to CCIE.
Yeah, don't let the jacket fool you. I've been at Cisco for almost 30 years. I do have a CCIE, master's in software, and I've been building routers and switches for most of my career.
That's fantastic. So there was an announcement here at Cisco Live about a new type of switch. It's called a smart switch, I believe. So can you take us on a journey? Like, how is this different to, say, a traditional switch? Why is it such a big thing in today's world?
Yeah, definitely. And first off, it's a smart switch, which doesn't mean the rest of our switches are not intelligent.
I know. I like that.
Confuses people sometimes. But the idea is, when we think about what's happening in networking and security and how we see these things coming together, we need to do some extra processing on packets as they come through. And we need to think about things like policy and segmentation in different ways. And so you can think of the smart switch if you don't use any of the extra smarts as a regular switch.
Okay.
So we have a top of rack variant and we have a 24-port 100 gig variant that you can put at the border of the network, or you know, as you're doing cloud on-ramp or something like that. But then the beauty of the DPU technology that we're using is you're basically adding hardware to the switch that enable us to then go and do extra processing on packets or look deeper at things. And so the switch itself is intelligent enough to know what traffic has to get sent to the DPU. And then we do the smart switching part of it. We do some intelligent processing on that and then send it back. And so it gives us an enforcement point in the network. We can do policy, we can do segmentation, and you're basically bringing a lot of these security elements that we used to do in a centralized firewall or something like that directly into the switch fabric itself.
My job is to ask some of the beginner questions that people might have.
Yeah.
So I've heard of a CPU. I've heard of an ASIC. The switch still have those? And, you know, what is a DPU, basically?
Yeah, it's kind of funny. So if you think about this little continuum of technology, CPUs are super programmable. You can write code, you can basically make it do anything.
Yep.
But in relative terms, it's low performance. I know our CPUs are really high performance, but in relative terms, low performance.
Yep.
An NPU or an ASIC is a extremely high bandwidth, very, very efficient forwarding device.
Okay.
But let's call it low programming. Ours are actually very programmable, so they're better than most NPUs, but in general, it's a little bit lower on the programming scale, so really, really fast, but you can't really tell it to do much. It's not meant to do. DPU kind of fits in the middle, where it's got some ARM cores, it's got some acceleration pipelines, and so it's reasonably programmable with reasonable forwarding capability. And so it kind of fits right in between a CPU and an ASIC. And so by attaching multiple DPUs to this switch, we can get switch level performance, so multiple hundreds of gigs of performance with programmability and the ability to accelerate pipelines like security.
So why couldn't you use an ASIC for this? Why did you have to use a DPU?
So over time, I actually hope that we can do some of the stuff in ASICs and
okay.
We can bring some of the stuff into chips. But if you think about it today, you know, an ASIC, the die size of the ASIC determines its cost, its power, and its efficiency effectively. And so the chips that we're building were built for a specific function. In these two different switches, we have the higher bandwidth switch has four DPUs and the lower bandwidth one has two.
Yep.
And so adding four of these big DPUs to a device and trying to stick it into the ASIC, the cost of the ASIC and the size of the ASIC would have gone way up. And so for most applications, I want that forwarding chip to be fairly lean. And so adding the DPUs was the right technology mix for today. But you know how technology works. In the next generation, when we get to the next ASIC node and we can build, you know, more and more transistors into a chip, hopefully we'll be able to actually integrate some of these DPU technologies or functions in.
So the one sort of theme I've heard is security. Can you give us some examples of what the DPU or this new switch is capable of doing that, say, a traditional switch is not capable of doing?
Yeah, definitely. And so think of it as that ASIC can do hardware-based forwarding. And so, you know, packet comes in, you have either a MAC address or an IP address, you look it up and you can forward and you can forward really, really quickly. You can do some features and some functions. We have some brute force things like access lists to do some amount of security. But when you think about a data center fabric, you think about segmentation and micro segmentation and policies. And so when you're looking at users and groups and having them have access to resources in a network, you need to have fairly fine-grained policies of which users can have access to, say, which types of data or which resources in the network. And what this new world, if we think about AI, we think about agentic AI and this idea that we're going to have a lot more people using a lot more resources in the network, the ability to look deeper at the packets and understand even down at the host itself, understand which applications are using this traffic and be able to apply policies to those and then segment or police them to have access or not have access in the network is what we're after.
Does this give you the Hypershield option or like the distributed firewall straight into the devices? Because when that was announced, they were talking about eBPF on the host, but there wasn't something on the switch. Is this what that is?
Yeah, see, I love it. Now we're getting deep into
Please go in.
This is perfect. So when we announced Hypershield, that's exactly what we announced, is we were taking some of the technologies that we acquired with iSurveillant.
Yep.
eBPF or extended Berkeley packet filters, that ability to, at the host, actually look at the packets coming through. So now you have a lot more granularity and you can see, you know, which applications are actually sending traffic where at the host itself.
Yep.
Right now, that can either be done in the host with an agent, or it can be done in a SmartNIC, or actually most of the SmartNICs have DPUs on them.
Okay.
This is actually where this idea came from.
Yep.
SmartNIC has a DPU, which is that programmable element that takes the CPU processing away from the CPU, puts it on the SmartNIC, so the CPU can run workloads and do what it's supposed to do. This is taking it one step further and allowing us to put that Hypershield technology onto the switch itself. And so it does two things. One, we can do it at much higher performance. Two, we can actually look at everything running through the fabric. So I actually don't have to have, every host doesn't have to have a Hypershield agent. Every server doesn't have to have a SmartNIC. Because the challenge of SmartNIC is it's a lot more expensive than a traditional NIC.
Yep.
Not every company or every customer is going to have the ability to put SmartNICs in every server. And not every server is going to be upgraded tomorrow. And so by moving this security technology into the fabric, we can actually look at things where you don't have the ability to enable Hypershield today, or stuff like mainframes and things that will probably never be able to support some of this technology and will probably be around forever as well.
Yeah, exactly. You're not going to get rid of them soon.
Yeah.
Is eBPF running on the switch or is it like a separate technology running on the DPU?
Yeah. So think of it as everything we would have been doing in that host agent or that DPU, we're bringing onto the switch itself. And it's kind of interesting because not many people have, or not many companies like Cisco have both the networking aspects of things and have high performance security and firewall functionality. And so the ability to bring these two together into a single device is probably something that only a company like Cisco can do. And that's actually where we think it's differentiated and interesting.
So is this specifically for AI or is it specifically for security or is it just like a whole breadth of applications?
So more specific, Hypershield is more specific to just security and melding or kind of fusing that security into the network. We think that there's a lot of applications as we move towards AI. This idea actually came out of something we were doing with Microsoft.
Okay.
We have another switch that runs Sonic. Sonic is an open source network operating system that was developed by Microsoft and then put into the open source community. They run it in a lot of their network and they went through this exact same journey. They had the SmartNICs in all their servers. They were deploying these SmartNICs. The problem is these DPUs are a couple hundred gigs and they weren't actually using that throughput. So they had added cost in the NIC and they weren't able to get the real value out of it. So then they built an appliance and they put six or eight of these things in the appliance. But then it was like a router on a stick, like all of our old architectures. When we couldn't do something, we'd just point it over and do it in appliance and send it back. And what they realized is if we're just going to send it out and send it back, if we could actually integrate these into the switch where all the traffic is going through, they can kind of cost optimize, meaning put eight of these DPUs for them in the switch and not have to deploy them in hundreds and hundreds of servers. So huge cost savings, and they got all the same functionality as when it was in the server itself. And so we've just taken that technology idea and applied it now to the Hypershield problem.
So Hypershield is one application, right? So
yeah.
My question was probably not great. What I was trying to allude to is, are there other applications coming? Sort of, where's this going? Because is this the first switch with a DPU, or perhaps you could just like, is that correct in saying it's the first one with a DPU?
So first switch with a DPU, yes. Or I definitely see us using more of these in future switch applications. The DPUs that we're using, they're already used in other applications where they do other types of services. So NAT services or IPsec services, they can be used to actually accelerate anything. So I can't tell you exactly what the next application is going to be. We're going to be focusing on Hypershield and getting that out because we do see a lot of value in that today, but we definitely do see other services coming on these devices.
This switch is specifically for the data center, right?
Yeah. It's a data center switch. It's the N9300. It's a series of smart switches. It's a Nexus product. And so it runs NXOS. It is managed by Nexus Dashboard. Actually, that's one cool thing about it. If you think about the way customers run networks today, you have network operations teams that build and manage the fabrics, and then you have security operations teams that apply policies and we're actually bridging some of those boundaries here, which sometimes can be a little bit challenging, but each of those software stacks has its own software lifecycle, is managed by a different group and a different application. So if you don't use any of the advanced services, it's a switch and you can deploy it anywhere in the network, like any other top of rack switch or Borderleaf or other device. And then when you enable the Hypershield technology, the Cisco Cloud Security Control manages the security policies on the device itself. So you can upgrade the security policies without touching the network and the connectivity there. And you can actually upgrade the network without having to touch the security policies around the device.
I mean, it sounds like security and networking are kind of melting together.
Yeah, exactly. And like I said, the cool thing about it is, if, say, a pure play networking vendor were going to try to go build this, they'd either have to build up an entire security practice or partner with somebody external, which is not an easy thing to do. So having both of these technologies in-house gives us a really cool advantage, I think, in bringing them together in ways you're not going to see from others in the market.
So it's great to see that, you know, Hypershield is now available on switches using the DPUs.
Yep.
AI is all the rage at the moment. Is that sort of an application that you guys are thinking about for the future? Is it something where this can be used as well?
Well, I'm amazed we got through this whole thing without talking about AI.
Yeah, exactly. So that was great. We've done well.
Yeah, obviously AI is top of mind for everybody. And when you think about how AI is being deployed today, it's mostly hyperscale. And if you look at the 90% of the GPUs being deployed, they're being bought by a small handful of companies. But we really do see AI coming into the enterprise. And as AI moves into the enterprise data center, one of the biggest concerns that a lot of our customers tell us about is security.
Yeah, exactly.
How do I make sure that, you know, if I'm running models or using my own data, everything around it is secure? And so I could absolutely see Hypershield and these DPU or smart switches playing a role there, where we can, you know, if you think of this future state of agentic AI and having agents as actually users in the network, everything we talked about before with policy and segmentation, you're going to have to do micro segmentation and much more fine-grained policy, because you might have, say, in a healthcare application, you might have an agent that knows everything about your health record, and it's communicating with an agent that understands how to prescribe drugs at what prescription levels based on what it knows about you. But that agent shouldn't know anything about you and your personal information. And so you could even think of needing like firewalls and networking between agents to make sure that they're communicating with the right things and only sharing the right amount of data. So absolutely, there's AI applications as we move forward.
Glad you mentioned that, because that's a huge paradigm shift, right? Because we used to thinking about like perhaps zero trust with users,
yeah,
and perhaps certain applications. But, you know, if agentic AI is the way that we're going, you could have like, I don't know, 10,000 or however number of these agents, and that's all going to be segmented as well.
Yeah. And so a lot of what we talked about, you know, outside of Hypershield, we launched some things called AI pods. We were talking about something called AI defense. What you're going to start to see is us building stacks that enable enterprises to roll out AI applications with security in mind. So if you look at what, say, a hyperscaler would do, they come to us for technology. They want ASICs or they want, you know, networking components, but they put the things together themselves. And we think the real value in enterprises is the ability to build, you know, Cisco-based networks, bring our networking technology, bring our security technology, and give them peace of mind that, you know, we're actually helping them deploy this stuff securely.
That's great, Kevin. Really appreciate you sharing. I could keep you here for much longer. I love talking, you know, getting into the nitty-gritty of this stuff. Where can people connect? Is it LinkedIn? What's a good place for people to connect and perhaps ask questions?
Yeah, LinkedIn's perfect. I actually love questions if people have them. I learn a lot from questions that come in. So feel free to connect and ask me anything you want. But thanks for having me.